Thank you very much. It's a real honor for me to be here. I just dashed over from the airport, just came in from Seattle. SeaTac, they call it. Let's turn in our Bibles, please, to 1 Timothy. First Timothy chapter 4. And a verse that is very familiar to all of you. 1 Timothy 4:1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly. So this is something very important, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith. We're talking about apostasy. This is not just a deception involving the world, but it's apparently involving those who at least profess to know Christ. They will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. I don't know how familiar you are with this or how much thought you have given to it, but devils have doctrines, and they're very consistent, the doctrines of devils. And you can travel around the world as I have done, you can investigate this sort of thing, and you will find that the same message comes out of Ouija boards, the same message comes out of the mouths of mediums, it comes out of hypnotic trances, it comes out of LSD trips, dictated by the so-called space brothers from UFOs, and it's very consistent, doctrines of devils. And here, this verse is saying that in the last days there will be those who presume to be Christians who will depart from the faith and who will actually give heed to these doctrines of devils presented to them by seducing spirits. I think when we read verses like this, we, you know, tend to maybe pass over it without really thinking deeply about it. And I would like to just think a bit about this verse this afternoon. Let me ask you a question. How many of you actually read Jonathan Livingston Seagull? Well, that's a fair number. All right. Now, those of you that did not read Jonathan Livingston Seagull, how many of you remember the book? Wow, look at that. Amazing. Tens of thousands of copies of Jonathan Livingston Seagull sold in Christian bookstores. It was simply Hinduism, doctrines of devils, literally, dressed up in positive mental attitude, success, motivation, psychological terminology. And maybe most of you know, or maybe most of you are not aware, but Richard Bach, the author of Jonathan Livingston Seagull, states that it was all dictated to him by a disembodied spirit on the astral plane. Seducing spirits, doctrines of devils, sold in Christian bookstores, read by a lot of Christians, and very often when I go into the office of a Christian businessman or into the home of Christians, there you will see Jonathan soaring through the air, beautiful picture of him, and underneath is the inevitable caption, "I can because I think I can," right? And of course, that's exactly what Obi-Wan said to Luke, you remember? Yoda I'm thinking of the second film. And you know, Yoda was a yogi, and I don't know how many of you noticed the serpent moving in and out of the frames of that film. giving his blessing, a benevolent presence, not a ferocious creature like Luke was confronting otherwise. And Yoda was a yogi who had Luke standing on his head going through various contortions in order to develop the mind power to raise his spaceship out of the swamp. And when Luke tried and failed, Yoda did it. And Luke is looking on and he says, "I don't believe it." And Yoda said, "That's your problem. If you only believed it, you could do it." There are a lot of sincere Christians who think that's what faith is. You're praying for something and you try to believe that what you're praying for will happen. And I hope every one of you understands that that is not faith. If you can make something happen by believing it will happen, then you don't need God. And you don't try to believe that what you're praying for will happen. You must believe that God will make it happen. Because Jesus said, "Have faith in God." And there's a big difference between believing that what I'm praying for will happen because I believe it will happen and thinking that that is faith, and believing that God is going to answer my prayer. And I do not have the faith to believe that the prayer will be answered if my faith is in God, unless I know that it is God's will, unless I know that this is when and how God is going to do it, that I am His chosen vessel to bring this about, that I am in a relationship of obedience, walking with Him in purity, a clean vessel, doing those things that are pleasing in His sight, and therefore I have confidence that whatever we ask according to His will, He hears us. But a lot of people are trying to get faith by believing that what they're praying for will happen. Well, Jonathan Livingston Seagull presented this kind of an idea. It was a self-improvement, psychological Hinduism dressed up in Western language. And I could give you so many examples, doctrines of devils, literally, that are sweeping our society and are being embraced within the church, and we want to talk a little bit about that today. Because I feel that something is going on in our society and in the church that I know that I have not yet come to grips with it, and I've been studying it for a long time. I think the depths of the seduction and the horror of what is actually happening is beyond our comprehension. And I'm trying to awaken myself to this and trying to awaken others. And the seduction of Christianity, which I presume some of you at least have read, only touched the tip of the iceberg. And we were very gentle. Some people don't think we were. We were very gentle. We could have given worse quotes and more quotes for everyone that we quoted. And we had to be gentle because the patient can only take so much medicine. And I think if we'd said much more, people wouldn't have believed it. But I would like to examine this a little bit with you this afternoon. Now, some people will say, "Well, this guy is sure negative, you know, he's just around on a negative trip." And frankly, I don't like that word. I don't like those words, positive and negative. It sounds like electricity. They are totally amoral. What do you mean by positive? I was speaking at a church north of Seattle last night, and the dear brother on the question and answer time and the microphone, he was talking about being positive and praying positive prayers and the positive confession of the Word of God. I said, "What do you mean positive?" I was on a talk show in Pittsburgh area about 3 months ago, and the owner of the station, the radio station, who was interviewing me, very much involved in positive confession, and he was going to straighten me out, and I'm willing to be straightened out. I would thank you. If I'm wrong, you correct me, and I would thank you. But I will only take the correction from the Word of God, not from the opinions of men. And In the course of the interview, he said, "Well, I think the Bible is the foremost positive mental attitude book in the world. What do you say to that?" And I said, "I don't want to embarrass you on radio." And he said, "Go ahead." So, so I said, "Well, you can get out your Strong's exhaustive concordance, and you can look up the word positive, you can look up the word mental, and look up the word attitude, and you won't find them. Doesn't it seem a bit odd that the foremost positive mental attitude book in the world doesn't even know this concept? It's an idea that was picked up out there and was brought into the church. And one thing you must be aware of is that much that is in the church today has that origin. It was not exegeted by men and women of God studying the Word of God on their knees. It was picked up out here. It's what C.S. Lewis said years ago is modernism or liberalism. It's taking the latest ideas from the world, dressing it up in biblical language, and passing it off as Christianity. And it is deadly. And it is seductive. Inner healing, for example, which we may get into a little bit later, was not discovered by men and women of God on their knees studying the Word of God. It came out of psychology. And I want to talk a bit about psychology. It is the biggest ripoff ever foisted on the human race. It does not have anything to offer. And I am absolutely staggered by the extent to which this now has a stranglehold on the church. And I don't think you could find a Christian college or university or a seminary across the country that is not involved to some extent in this sort of thing. And now that I stuck my foot in it before I really wanted to get into psychology, I'd better follow up a little bit. I don't know how many of you are aware that they just had, well, last December, they had the largest gathering of psychologists and psychiatrists in the history. It was in Phoenix, Arizona. There were 7,000 of them there, and they had to turn 3,000 away. It was a very important event because all the living masters of psychology were there. And it's probably the last time they would all be together because they're dying off. They're very elderly. They met to discuss, these are the leaders now of this profession from around the world, they met to discuss where psychology had come from and where it was going in the 100 years since Freud. They could not agree on either. To show you the amount of agreement present, they had a panel of four of the leading experts on schizophrenia discussed schizophrenia before this august gathering. Three of them said schizophrenia doesn't exist. R.D. Lang said it didn't exist until somebody invented the word. And Thomas Szasz, one of the most famous psychiatrists in the world today, said it may make the Hinckleys feel good to have their son diagnosed as a schizophrenic when he's really just a bum. You might find a value, a book that I would recommend to you. It's called Inside the Criminal Mind. And I'm sorry, the name of the author slips me at the moment. He's a clinical psychologist, and he and a psychiatrist worked for years with criminals. And they found, to their astonishment, that they had to throw out everything that they had learned from psychology. And they discovered that people are criminals. Not because they were raised in a ghetto, not because they suffered traumas, not because they were abused in their childhood, sexually or any other way, not because they suffered from poverty or lack of advantage, but simply because they decided to be criminals. And that all of the psychological, psychotherapeutic techniques and the effort and the government money that is being spent is wasted. And you will never get anywhere until this person admits that they decided to be a criminal, and they, for good reasons, decide not to be. a criminal. R.D. Lang, one of the great masters that was at this gathering in Phoenix, and listen, this is not Dave Hunt, this idiot, you know, who goes around bad-mouthing psychology. You see, when you say the things that I say, it sounds like you just stepped off of another planet somewhere, because psychology has been accepted in our society. It is like motherhood and apple pie. It is a given, and it is Satan's masterstroke of genius. And R.D. Lang, listen to what he said, one of the great masters. He said, I cannot think of one thing that psychology has offered the human race of any benefit in the area of interpersonal relationships in its entire history. He said, we haven't gotten beyond Plato or Aristotle. We haven't gotten beyond Shakespeare. And Dr. Joseph Volpe, one of the great masters who was there from Europe, and I'm quoting him verbatim, and these men don't know what they're saying. He said, who would have imagined that the evolution of psychology would come to this, a babel of conflicting voices, unquote. Babel, Babylon, revived again, as the Word of God says, for the last days, and this is at the heart of the false religion that is yet going to sweep this world, to be headed up by the Antichrist. Let me tell you what Alice Bailey had to say about psychology. And she is, if you've read any of Constance Cumby's books, she talks about Alice Bailey a great deal as one of the forerunners of the New Age movement today, a very heavily demonized woman, who, by the way, was an apostate, who was married at one time to a Protestant minister and turned totally from the faith. She says, quote, the major science, this is out of her book, Esoteric Psychology, Volume 2. She said, the major science today is psychology. It is one that is yet in its infancy, but it holds the fate of humanity in its grasp. R.D. Lang said at that gathering, he said, in my current bout with depression, so if you have problems with depression, don't go to R.D. Lang. You better go to the Word of God. There's the answer. Go to the Lord. Go to the cross. Galatians 2:20, that'll get rid of your depression. Begin to think about others instead of yourself. R.D. Lang said, in my current bout with depression, I have found something more beneficial than anything psychotherapy has to offer. Wow, you're sitting on the edge of your seat waiting to hear what this is. He says, you hum a favorite tune. You could laugh yourself silly going to these things and listening to what these men say. If it were not so serious, we ought to weep the millions of lives that are being destroyed by these men. And he said, you want to know what my tune is? Keep right on to the end of the road. Keep right on to the end of the road. Yeah, keep a stiff upper lip. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, and the end thereof are the ways of death, and they're leading millions in their wake. And Carl Rogers, good old Carl, who has impacted our society as much as any living person today and the Church of Jesus Christ, he received a standing ovation before he said a word. This is Carl Rogers, who got in touch with the spirit world through a medium in a seance in South America. This is Carl Rogers, who got in touch with the spirit of his dead wife, Helen, through a Ouija board. And he had a bit of a guilty conscience because they'd had a long and happy marriage, but during the last 5 years, he had told her he was going to take his own way. And coincident with her death, he developed another relationship. You know how he got delivered from his guilt? Why, Helen came on through the Ouija board, and, you know, from the other side, and his dead wife's spirit said, enjoy, Carl, enjoy, be free. And Carl says, by gosh, what a wave of relief swept over me. Wasn't that terrific? Seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And they are in touch with them, and psychology comes right out of the pit of hell. The major theories come from a man named Sigmund Freud, as you know, who gave us a couple of myths, psychic determinism and the unconscious. And that forms the basis of all inner healing out there, and you know where he got it? It came from his patients when he hypnotized them. And hypnosis is right out of the pit of hell. And there is no possible way you can say that if a medical doctor hypnotizes you, it's okay. But if an occultist hypnotizes you, you got problems. The demons don't go by those rules. They don't care who hypnotizes you. You put yourself in a state of consciousness where the hypnotist can control you. Don't you think other minds can control you? You have opened yourself to demonic delusion. And you can not only be regressed into the childhood, as Sigmund Freud did with his patients, but you can take them right into the womb and come out with factual memories of the birthing process, in spite of the scientific fact that the myelin sheathing in the brain of the prenatal, natal, and early postnatal infant is not sufficiently developed to carry memories. Well, where do the memories come from? Same place they come from when you regress them right on through the womb into prior lives. And they come out with factual data of lives they've lived all over this earth. And they've never been there, and you can check up on it. You're either going to believe in reincarnation, or you're going to believe in seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And this is one of their doctrines, right out of the mouth of the serpent in the Garden of Eden: you won't die. There's no death. Don't worry about it, Eve. And talk about being positive. He was very positive. And God was so negative, he said, there's a tree in the middle of this garden. If you eat it, you're dead. And that's about as negative as you can get. And Satan was so positive, he said, don't worry about it. It's okay. You're going to be all right. You got to have an optimistic outlook on life. You got to be positive about this thing. In fact, it's going to make a god out of you. And you know that was the third lie. And you'll find that woven all through here. Carl Jung said, I have called this center the self. It might equally well be called the God within us. And Abraham Maslow said, the deeper we penetrate, the more universal into ourselves, the more universality we find. At men's deepest levels, they seem to be more alike than different. With the aid of a therapist, you can discover not only yourself, but the whole human spirit, because all is one. And then he says this, the non-academic psychologists of the East. You know who he's referring to. The gurus, the yogis, the swamins, the shamans, the witch doctors, the medicine men. They're psychologists, he says. Yes, indeed, they are psychologists. And we had a test not too long ago where they matched Western psychiatrists with witch doctors from the East. And it came out a dead heat. The only difference was that the witch doctors released their patients sooner and charged them less. I'm just telling you the facts. He says, what we're lately discovering through LSD and yoga and so forth, the non-academic psychologists of the East have always known. We in the West must learn it too. You know, in Matthew 16, Jesus was very negative. He said, I'm going to Jerusalem and they're going to kill me. And Peter was very positive. He said, Lord, I know I know you're really discouraged and you're down on yourself, and I know you got a bad self-image and so forth, but Lord, you got to have a bright outlook on life. Get thee behind me, Satan. Positive and negative. And two men went in the temple. I don't want to run this into the ground, but you know, two men went in the temple to pray. You remember that. One of them had down to a fine science what the psychologists call positive self-talk. We used to call it bragging. They redefine everything. Guilt is a complex. And listen, you know what Thomas says? Take this from a non-practicing Jewish psychiatrist. He says, we have turned the salvation of sinful souls into the cure of sick minds. Here's one of the leading psychiatrists in the world. He says, you Christians have the answer. You ought to take this back into the church. What's it doing out here? We got nothing to offer. And you know that the church today is the largest referral agency to psychiatrists and psychologists. Because, of course, you need professional help. What do you mean, professional help? Jay Ziskin, psychologist with California State University system, says a psychiatric diagnosis is more likely to be wrong than right. You think they are so professional? A psychologist from Stanford University put several of his friends up to a little scheme. They all got themselves admitted to different psychiatric hospitals around California because they were hearing voices and so forth. They claimed to have certain classic symptoms, and after they got in, they couldn't get out. And the patients in the psychiatric hospitals recognized them immediately as phonies. They couldn't convince the doctors that they were phonies. Well, there was a psychiatric hospital in California that heard about this. And they said, you couldn't fool us like that. And so they said, okay, over the next 6 months, we will send you an undetermined number of patients. And at the end of 6 months, we'll see how accurate you were. It threw that hospital into a turmoil. The doctors were arguing with one another. I think that's a phony. No, I don't think that's a phony. And at the end of the 6 months, they had come up, I think, with 28 that they thought were phonies. How many did you send? Zero. You can go to any court. Fortunately, they're going to stop this sort of thing, we hope. And you've got half a dozen psychiatrists with credentials as long as your arm on one side declaring very solemnly under oath that the defendant was insane at the time of the crime and ought to be found not guilty by reason of insanity. And you've got an equal number of equally erudite psychiatrists on the other side declaring that the defendant was sane and ought to be found guilty. They can't tell the difference between sanity and insanity. And you need professional help? You've got Clyde Naremore on the 700 Club, and he's being interviewed by Pat Robertson. And Pat says, well, Clyde, what do you think about somebody like Jay Adams, who basically says, if you're filled with the Spirit, you're mature in the faith, you know the Word of God, you're competent to counsel from the manufacturer's handbook. And Clyde gets a rather patronizing look on his face, and he says, well, you understand, of course, he doesn't have a degree. Now, we just threw Peter out, and we threw Paul out, and we threw James and John, and we threw Moody and Spurgeon and Finney and everybody out until these godless atheists, Freud and Jung and Rogers and Maslow and these guys came along with their godless theories. Of course, you understand why, because all truth is God's truth. And what that means is that the Holy Spirit, either through ignorance or oversight, failed to inspire the apostles who wrote the New Testament with parts of God's truth that he has lately inspired these godless psychiatrists and psychologists. And we'll take God's truth from anybody, even from the mouth of the devil himself. And that's where you're getting it. And when I say to you, there is no such thing as Christian psychology, then you think, wow, what a radical statement. The guy has to really be flipped out to say that. Well, you see, most Christians are under the mistaken idea that there is a body of knowledge out here consistent within itself known as Christian psychology. And it does not exist. There is no Christian who is on a par with Freud, Fromm, Rogers, Maslow, Jung, whoever you want to name, who is the founder of a school of psychology known as Christian psychology. Does not exist. Well, then what is Christian psychology? Well, Christian psychology is simply taking from these godless atheists and picking up this theory or that theory and then trying to fit it in with the Bible and calling it biblical. And you have almost as many schools of Christian psychology as you have of secular psychology. And I don't care what theory of psychology you embrace and try to call it Christian, you have thousands of Christians and non-Christians, psychologists and psychiatrists, who disagree with you. There is no such thing as Christian psychology. Christian psychology runs the whole gamut, all the way from primal scream. You got Christian psychologists who practice primal scream, and you dress your patients in baby diapers and put them in adult-sized cribs and have them rolling around sucking a bottle and cuddling a doll and screaming, "Mommy, Daddy, I hate you," because they got to go back into the past to relive this incident that tipped the scale and brought them into this traumatic thing that has made them what they are today. I didn't intend to get off on this. I don't know how I did, but it is incredible. It is absolutely incredible that we have believed this. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says, well, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for what comes first? Doctrine. When did you last hear some good doctrine on Christian television? Well, Chuck Smith. You got to look pretty far. You got a few people on there that are giving it to you, but you're not going to get it generally. Profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness. Not how to speak in tongues, but instruction in righteousness. Those who hunger and thirst after righteousness will be filled. Not somebody that gets a quick fix with a laying on of hands and I pray in tongues and you repeat after me, you know, and then go home and practice your language. That's not the way it happens. And I don't mean to offend people, but we better get back to the Bible. That the man, the woman of God may be what? Perfect, mature, complete, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. 2 Peter chapter 1. He has given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who has called us to glory and virtue. All things that pertain unto life and godliness, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature. We're partakers of the divine nature. Divine nature needs psychotherapy. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, and beside all this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, etc., etc. You know the scriptures. We are branches in the true vine. We have the mind of Christ. We are promised the peace of God that passeth all understanding. It's supernatural from God Himself. You know what we have done? We have done exactly what the Israelites did. And you know what Jeremiah said to them, God speaking through Jeremiah. He said, "My people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and they have dug them out cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. And we have gone to the polluted wells of this world, and they themselves admit they don't have anything to offer, and we have forsaken the Word of God and the solution that God offers." Well, I got off on that because this guy is in the temple. Positive self-talk. He had positive self-talk down to a fine science, you know. He said, "Lord, I thank you. I'm not one of the baddies. I'm one of the goodies. I'm not like this publican. You know, I'm not a sinner. I pray and I fast and I tithe." And Jesus said he prayed with himself. And that other fellow was so negative, he dare not lift up his eyes to heaven. He beat upon his breast and he said, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." And Jesus said, "I tell you, he went away justified." Of course, that's that old worm theology that people don't want to hear today. Yeah, I'm a worm. I'm a sinner saved by grace, and you will never get beyond that. Oh, you got to build up your self-esteem. You got to feel good about yourself. And if you don't realize, you know, you have a sense of self-worth, how could you believe that God would love you? Well, that's the Hollywood kind of love. You love the lovely. God loved a world of sinners lost and ruined by the fall. He loves us because He is love, not because we're worth it, not because we're lovely. Oh, well, you want to know your true worth. Look at the price that God paid for you, the blood of Jesus. That's what you're worth. It must be because that's what God paid. You think God got a bargain? You think He paid equal value? What about the satisfaction of His righteous claims against sin? What about His honor? What about grace? You don't pay equal value when it's grace. It's something we did not deserve. And you know, Jesus was in the home of the Pharisee Simon. And this woman was washing His feet with her tears and wiping them with her hair. And Simon was, you know, thinking within himself, yeah, he was really a prophet. He would realize she's a sinner. And Jesus said, Simon, I got something to say to you. And he said, go ahead, Lord. And Jesus said, there was a creditor, and he had two debtors, and one owed him a huge sum, and the other owed him almost nothing, and he forgave both of them. Now, who do you think would love him the most? Well, Simon said, I guess the one that he forgave the most. And Jesus said, you have spoken well. I came into your house, walking the dusty roads. You didn't give me any water to wash my feet. This woman has not ceased to wash my feet with her tears. You gave me no towel. She has dried my feet with her hair. To whom much is forgiven, she loved much. To whom little is forgiven, he loveth little. And Jesus seems to be saying that you are going to love him and you are going to appreciate and worship the more conscious you are of your unworthiness. And the more you realize that you do not deserve this, you are a wretched sinner, unworthy of his grace. And the deeper you realize he has reached down to lift you up, that's going to cause great joy and great wonder and worship forever and forever and forever. And you will never get beyond this. And our song in heaven will be, oh, what worthy creatures we are. No. Our song in heaven will be, unto him who loved us and loosed us from our sins in his own blood. Yes, he made us a kingdom of priests, and we will reign with him, but we cannot divorce ourselves from our origin. We will always be sinners saved by his grace. Well, so much for positive and negative, which I didn't intend to talk about, so let's get going here fast. You go back to Genesis 3, and we find where this thing began. The serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field. Beware of subtlety. Beware of cleverness in your ministry as pastors or evangelists. Beware of psyching somebody up into something. He wasn't truthful. He wasn't godly. It had nothing to do with the power of the Holy Spirit bringing conviction, but it was subtle. It was clever. It was persuasive, but the wrong kind of persuasion. And beware that we don't persuade people with the wisdom of men. But as Paul said, my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power. He was more subtle than any beast of the field, and he said to the woman, hath God said? Did God really say that? That, of course, as you know, is the way every cult begins. Oh, you think God said that? Well, now, wait a minute. Joseph Smith got a revelation, and there's not a Christian on the face of the earth, but he's been ordained of God to begin true Christianity. Or Herbert W. Armstrong said the gospel wasn't preached, the true gospel wasn't preached on this earth for 18 and a half centuries until I began my radio ministry in 1934. Or Mary Baker Eddy wrote Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures. And nobody understood the Scriptures until she gave us the key. And to this day, every Christian Science church around the world takes its sermons from the Mother Church in Boston because Mary Baker Eddy had the revelation. There is a kind of guruism in the Church of Jesus Christ, unfortunately. And we can see it in them, but we don't see it in ourselves. That's one of the reasons, believe it or not, when we wrote this book, we were not going to use names. One reason was we did not want to give people a billy club to pound ministries and individuals over the head with, because you point out something that may not be biblical in their ministry doesn't mean that everything else in their ministry is wrong. But one of the major reasons we didn't want to use names is because if you do use names, there are a lot of people who have elevated these individuals up to onto a pedestal of infallibility, and as soon as you name their Christian guru, they won't hear another word you say. We gave one quote of James Dobson. We didn't even put his name in the body of the book. You got to look in the footnotes to find out who it was that we're quoting. And you ought to hear the screams. How dare you question the national champion of Christian values, the foremost expert on the Christian family in the whole world? Well, my response is, I'm sure that James Dobson would be very upset if he knew that there were people out there who apparently think he's infallible. We better question one another. And that's one of the problems. We've got a lot of personalities, many of them on television, and we don't question them. And there are millions of Christians out there who just accept what these people say. And they can lead you down the path to destruction, unless you are like the Bereans. Check out what Dave Hunt says. Check out what Chuck Smith says. Check out what anybody says. The Bereans didn't accept what the great Apostle Paul said just because of who he was. But they searched the Scriptures daily to see whether these things were so. Daily they searched the Scriptures to see whether these things were so. And they are commended by the Holy Spirit for having done so. And 1 Corinthians 14:29 says, let the prophets speak and let the others judge. People say, judge not lest you be judged. Well, Jesus is saying, don't judge hearts. And some of you as some of us, include myself, as husbands and wives, we judge our mates that way. Oh, I know what you're thinking. I can tell by that look on your face, tone of your voice or whatever. And we're judging hearts. We are not to judge hearts, but we must judge lives. We must judge doctrine. And we are commanded to do so. And that's one of the problems with Christian television. You can't judge. Somebody has a word of knowledge. Something's happening out there. You got no way. I believe that the gifts of the Spirit should function within the body of believers. And you got no way to check up on this, and you got no way to judge what's going on. And it has gotten out of hand. And I guess some of you are aware that Johnny Carson just exposed Peter Popoff recently. Has a little hearing, very sophisticated hearing device in his ear. And his wife is transmitting the data to him so he can give words of knowledge and call out names and addresses and so forth from behind stage. Where are those with discernment in the body of Christ? Why don't we expose this? Why are we embarrassed by the world exposing? And who are the hundreds of thousands, perhaps millions, of Christians without discernment who support a ministry like this? And he's not the only one that might fit into that category. We must judge. People say, touch not the Lord's anointed. Well, we don't have time to turn to the Scriptures, but that first comes up in 1 Samuel 24, where you remember David was hiding in the cave with his men, and they were being pursued by Saul. And what do you know? Saul came in and lay down and took a nap. And David's men says, the Lord has delivered your enemy into your hands. Smite him. And David was going to do it, and he contemptuously cut off a part of the skirt of his robe, and then he was smitten in his conscience, and he said, God forbid that I should touch the Lord's anointed. That's what it means in the Bible. You get it in Psalm 105. He suffered them not to touch his anointed or to do his prophets harm. That was, he wouldn't allow the enemies of Israel to harm them. But in 1 Samuel 26, David is being pursued again, and there's a deep sleep from the Lord has come upon Saul and all of his army. And David and Abishai go down to the host of Israel. And they take Saul's spear and his cruse of water, his canteen, and they get up on a safe place. And then they yell and they awaken the host. And again on this occasion, David says, I won't touch the Lord's anointed. But he first of all addresses Abner, the general of the army, and he says, Abner, you are worthy of death. You ought to die. You have the job of guarding the king's head. And there came enemies in, and they could have killed the king. And look, we've got his spear and his canteen. And then he addressed Saul. No, he didn't touch the Lord's anointed. He rebuked the Lord's anointed in front of the armies of Israel and in front of all of his men. And he said, Saul, why are you pursuing me? like a partridge in the desert. What have I ever done to merit this? And Saul repents. Of course, David was smart enough to know it didn't really mean anything. It didn't change his heart. Saul invites David back. You can't use that verse. That's either a very ignorant or a dishonest use of the scripture. When you say, touch not the Lord's anointed, that means, well, you dare not question what some great man of God is saying. You better question. Or you are setting them up to be a guru, and you're setting the church up for the same. But the serpent says, did God say? Well, let me explain it to you. Right from the serpent, we get the idea that you can play fast and loose with God's word. That there's some kind of an esoteric interpretation that other people don't know. I don't know how many of you saw it, but Frederick Price was on the Channel 40 a few months ago being interviewed by Paul and Jan. He was giving the standard explanation of Hebrews 11 verse 3. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, and so forth. And of course the standard explanation from the positive confession people is, we understand that it was by faith that God framed the worlds. And faith is a power. Kenneth Copeland said it on the same show, February 5th, you could get the tape, 1986. He said, faith is a force, just like electricity and gravity, and it works by laws the same way. And Frederick Price was saying, you know, faith is a power. And God used this power called faith to create the world. And this is their explanation of it. And this power is contained in words. And when you speak these words, it releases this power. God said, let there be light. God said. You see what you can do by speaking words? No, there was light when God said, let there be light, because it was God who said, let there be light. Not because there's power in words. But they would give you the impression that you can speak words and release this power, and therefore you better not make a negative confession, because a negative confession is just as powerful as a positive confession. And if you say, I've got a cold, you're going to get it. But even if your nose is running, then you must say, I don't have a cold, and it will go away. And Hal Lindsey was watching the show, and he became very angry. And he got on the phone, and he called in, and he said to the person the counselor, he said, look, this is Hal Lindsey. You take this right to Paul right now, and you tell him that there is no one in the entire world who knows anything about Greek, who knows anything about exegeting the Bible, who would agree with that. That just is not so. And he watched as they took it up to Paul, and Paul looked at it, and he said, well, there are some people who have a revelation about prophecy, but they don't have a revelation about what we're talking about. That's not the way it comes. No prophecy of the scriptures of any private interpretation. And you don't have to have some inside track. You only have to be willing to be taught by the Spirit of God and be submissive to His will. If any man wills to do His will, Jesus said in John 7:17, he will know. You can play fast and loose with the Bible. You can come up with all kinds of incredible interpretations. On that same February 5th program, Kenneth Copeland said, you want to know what it means in Galatians 6, where it says, be not deceived, God is not mocked, whatever a man sows, he will reap. That means if you plant money in a ministry, you should expect to reap money in return. And if you don't expect to get money back, 30, 60, 100 fold, you're mocking God. The scripture says, he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, and he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And if you're expecting to get money back when you give to a ministry, that's not giving, that's investing. And 1 Corinthians 13 tells you, you can give all your goods to feed the poor, you can give your body to be burned, and if you don't do it out of love, love expects nothing in return. It will profit you nothing. This simply is not what the Bible says. But these ideas are being promulgated and they're being accepted. And I think that we have to stand up and say enough is enough. We have to say we want to get back to the Bible. Now, if you turn to Isaiah 14, I mean, I'm not giving you any revelations. These are things you all know. Isaiah 14 and verse 12. we get the origin of this sort of thing. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? Thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. Verse 14, I will be like the Most High, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. How many Most Highs can you have? Well, you can only have one. I see Bob Ellis smiling. That's one of the arguments, and Chuck there, and that's one of the arguments we present to the Mormons, right? Who believe in a lot of gods. You can only have one Most High. So Satan, and that's called monotheism, not monism. Monism means all is one. Monotheism means there's only one God. And in one swoop of selfish ambition, Satan did away with monotheism and he introduced polytheism. He said, there isn't going to just be one God, the Most High. There's going to be a lot of gods, and I'm going to be one of them. Because God didn't make this universe out of nothing. You can't make something out of nothing. It's an extension of Him. It's part of Him. And this power is available to all of us. And if you know how to tune in, you can get this power too. And we can all be gods. I mean, we're not going to bow to Him anymore. But we got plenty of power on our own. And so he did away with monotheism and he introduced polytheism. Well, you know, going back now, sorry, should have told you, hold your finger there. Going back to Genesis 3, well, you don't need to turn to it. You know these verses so well. He tells her she's not going to die. No, God is not going to bring the judgment upon you that he said he will. It breaks my heart. I was weeping on the plane flying down. And I was thinking, I don't think we've yet come to grips with the seriousness of what's happening. I was thinking of the words of C.S. Lewis, who said, we just don't seem to realize that every person that we confront, family members, friends in our neighborhood, at work, wherever they are eternal beings who are either going to shine like the stars forever, or they're going to be horrible creatures separated from God and in misery forever and forever. And you begin to come to grips with that. It gives us a new outlook on life and the seriousness of the ministry that has been committed to us. And the seriousness of diluting the gospel and playing games with God's word and presenting things to people that are not true and that will not bring them to the real Jesus. And it's happening all around us. It's within the Church of Jesus Christ. One of my favorite authors way back there, William Law, he used various, gave his characters Latin names, and I can't remember the name that he gave to this pastor. But he said of this particular pastor, he said, he learned the eternal value of souls by appearing so often in the presence of God on their behalf. A man of prayer. And we begin to realize the seriousness of the issues that we're dealing with. And Satan said, don't worry about it. No judgment's going to come. In fact, you're going to become a god. But what does he say? Verse 5. God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened. You're going to be God Almighty, the Most High. No, he didn't say that. You will be as the gods. You're going to be one of us. There's a lot of gods out there. She didn't know he meant you're going to be one of us. She didn't know who he was. She didn't know how horrible this trip was that she was being introduced to. I think of young man that Brad Steiger talks about. Brad Steiger is one of the ufologists, and in his book Gods of Aquarius, he tells about a friend of his who awakened the kundalini through yoga. Of course, that's the goal of yoga, to awaken the serpent power and develop this psychic power. And he said he found himself conversing with a serpent as real as life, but it was like a cloud of death. And at first he was frightened, but then he became enamored with this invader of his world. And finally, he would have rather died than be separated from this serpent who had become his best friend. And finally, he said, the serpent revealed that he was his true self. Talk about the shell game switch. people that are looking within to find the true self, and having found self, finding God. And who have they found? Satan. And they end in hell, separated from the true God, where I just came from in Seattle. Some of you know, pastor of the First Baptist Church, Seattle, Washington, has written a book called Journey to Inner Space, Finding God in Us. And in large print on the back of the cover, it says, Mission to Find God, Method by Finding Ourselves. That's the self that I just quoted from Carl Jung. He said it's the God within. This is from the Seattle Post-Intelligencer just before New Year's. One of their popular columnists up there, Jennifer James, PhD in psychology. She says, what I offer for the new year is a path that jumped out of the pages of M. Scott Peck's book, The Road Less Traveled. Scott Peck's two books, The Road Less Traveled and People of the Lie, were number 6 and number 7 on Eternity Magazine Book of the Year list, voted in by leading evangelicals. He's a psychiatrist that they think has come to Christ. I think he's had a Jungian conversion. And if I can take a few more minutes, I want to explain a little bit about that. She says, what I offer for the new year is a path that jumped out of the pages of Scott Peck's book, The Road Less Traveled. I had felt but never dared articulate the obvious result of the growing recognition of the presence of a universal part of the Spirit within all of us. And now she quotes Scott Peck, and we quote him in The Seduction of Christianity. No matter how much we may like to pussyfoot around it, all of us who postulate a loving God and really think about it eventually come to a single terrifying idea. God wants us to become himself or herself or itself. We are growing toward Godhood. God is the goal of evolution. It is God who is the source of the evolutionary force and God who is the destination. Exactly what Rodney R. Romney had to say. And I have an article from the Seattle Post-Intelligencer, May 3rd, 1986. The Reverend Rodney Romney, First Baptist pastor, declines to respond to Hunt's attack. The pervasive theme in Christianity is love and acceptance, Romney says, not fear. That's a popular idea that's out there. By faith, Noah, being warned of God, moved with of things not seen as yet, moved with fear. Fear, the fear of God, is the beginning of wisdom, the beginning of knowledge, and it is lacking in Christianity today. A sense of awe and reverence before the holy presence of God. He says the pervasive theme in Christianity is love and acceptance, not fear. Jesus certainly warned people of hell. Well, let me just go on and read. You might be interested in some of the reactions of some of these people on the subject that we're talking on right now. Casey Treat, he says, the dynamic 30-year-old pastor of Christian Faith Center, says Hunt took his sermon describing humans as exact duplicates of God out of context. I don't know how you can take a sermon out of context. I don't teach that we're all gods, Treat says. That's not what I believe. Nonetheless, Treat says tapes of that particular sermon have been withdrawn to avoid confusion. Well, well, I have on Casey Treat's letterhead, April 16, 1986. He says, animals were not created in the image of God. That's the same thing that Kenneth Copeland said to Paul and Jan when they said, well, these people that criticize you, they say you're teaching that we're little gods. Well, Gloria Copeland said we're his offspring. And Ken Copeland says, we're not in the animal class. When animals produce, they have animals. When God produces, what do you think he produces? We're in the God class. And he says, animals were not created in the image of God and were not given dominion on the earth. We're children of God, created in his image and given authority to rule in the planet earth. We are gods in that sense. That puts us in God's class. Then he says, Jesus is the chief pastor or shepherd in the body of Christ, but there are local pastors or shepherds here on earth. We are gods on this earth in the same sense. He says he doesn't teach it. This is April 16th, 1986. And in his latest book that came out after The Seduction of Christianity, it's pretty clear. I don't know. He may be confused. I don't know. But I thought you would be interested. I was horrified. And I would have to say that I never expected the uproar that we got from the seduction of Christianity. But I am really distressed by the reaction of many of these people. They are not willing to be corrected. They are stiffening their position. I was told immediately after the book came out, early in September, last September, I was told that John Wimber was very unhappy about some of the things we'd said and wanted to talk with me. I immediately called his office. He was out. His secretary said he would return the call. He never did. When he didn't return the call, I wrote a letter. When he didn't answer that, I wrote another one and sent a copy of the first letter. I tried for about 6 months to get in touch with him. But yet there were rumors circulating that we had met and I had apologized and we were taking out of the book any reference to the vineyards. It simply is not true. But to my knowledge, to this day, the vineyards are still selling and recommending Agnes Sanford, Morton Kelsey, who was a union psychologist. Morton Kelsey was Agnes Sanford's pastor here in Monrovia. And he and Jack Sanford, John Sanford, you'll get his books in the book, Christian bookstores, Morton and John went to the C.G. Jung Institute in Zurich to study union psychology, and they became thoroughgoing unions. And Morton Kelsey says that Jesus is a witch doctor, a shaman. He had the ESP powers of the shamans, and we need to develop these powers in the church today. February 13th, Golden Gate Baptist Theological Seminary in Mill Valley, California, a mainline Southern Baptist seminary, Professor Doran C. McCarty preached the opening invocation for talk for the first chapel service of the new semester, and the title of it was The Making of a New Shaman. And he said Jesus was a shaman, like Morton Kelsey. He follows in the shamanic tradition, and we have to develop these shamanic powers in the church today to bring power back in the Church of Jesus Christ. They still recommend Morton Kelsey, who advocates Ouija boards, communication with the dead. Agnes Sanford, we've been accused of taking things out of context. If there's anything we've taken out of context, we would certainly change it if anyone will show it to us. But Agnes Sanford said the blood of Jesus is present on this earth in plasma form, blown by the winds to the four corners, exploding in cosmic power. Agnes Sanford said that when you're speaking in tongues, you're in communication with people all over this world, or people who used to live here and now have died, the dead, or with the spirits of those who haven't yet arrived on this planet, because she believed in a pre-existence like the Mormons, and she said we come trailing a cloud of glory to this earth, or with some great being of light. She talked about being out of her body and blessing people on the astral plane, and therefore if you have any problems, call upon me. I don't care what context you put that in. You can't whitewash statements like that in any context. And I have a tape of Kenneth Copeland talking about the same thing. Only he missed the opportunity. God was giving him an opportunity to go out of his body and to move across and bless people out there in his spiritual body. And he withdrew, and that brought the rebuke of God upon his ministry. Bruce Larson, author of 15 Christian books, says he is, quote, unashamedly guilty of Hunt's charges of writing favorably about psychotherapy, self-help psychology, meditation, and wholeness doctrines. But so what, he says. We can learn from non-Christians, Larson says. I eat the meat and spit out the bones. The University Presbyterian pastor says Hunt's idea that Christians cannot use anything that doesn't come right out of the Bible does a dishonor to the Holy Spirit and personal freedom. It's a fearful view, Larson says. Well, I certainly don't think you ought to get your chemistry lessons out of the Bible, or, you know, learn your aerodynamics from the Bible. You can fly with a pilot who's a Hindu or a Buddhist. Unfortunately, sometimes people like this are more compassionate and more competent than some of us, if we're honest about it. But don't let them counsel you in spiritual matters. It's one thing to fly with a Hindu pilot in a big jet. It's another thing to let him take you off on a spiritual trip. And we only go to the Word of God for counsel in the area of spiritual concerns. But psychology is the study of the psyche, the knowledge of the psyche. Carl Jung said it's the knowledge of the psyche. Psyche is the Greek word for soul, and we don't know what soul is. What are non-Christians doing delving into the area of the soul and the spirit when the Bible claims to have the soul answer? Well, I might as well finish. Rita and Reverend Dennis Bennett, the Edmonds-based charismatics, say their writings also have been misinterpreted by Hunt. This guy is a terrible misinterpreter. Dennis Bennett, an Episcopal priest, says that if Hunt wants to condemn visualization, imagery, and meditation counseling techniques used by the Bennetts, he might as well condemn prayer. I think there's a big difference. We'd better awaken to it. Seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. I don't know how many of you are aware of it. Shirley MacLaine, you're going to have within a few days or a few weeks at the most on national television, a national television network, you're going to have the story of Shirley MacLaine's life out on a limb. And are you aware that for the first time you're going to have on television a series, a five-part series, where the script was literally written by demons? It was channeled through mediums from these entities, she calls them, and they literally wrote the script, seducing spirits, and that script will contain doctrines of devils in our modern age on television. And they gave directions to the director and to the producers, to the actors and actresses. Well, what do you think they said? It didn't blow away here somewhere. For you see, here's a communication she received. For you see, each soul is its own God. You must never, this is verbatim from the entities, you must never worship anyone or anything other than self, for you are God. To love self is to love God. Well, you got a popular song going on now. Love of self is the best love and the easiest love to get into, to love yourself. Another transmission she received said, if anyone was taught one basic spiritual law, your world would be a happier, healthier place. And that law is this: everyone is God. Everyone. Well, I have a standard response to that, to my New Age friends. If you're God and I'm God, and that would explain why the world is in a mess. It wouldn't offer any hope. We're not out of touch with our higher self. We're out of touch with God. And we need to get back in submission to Him. Well, now, if Satan is going to make us all think that we're gods, how's he going to do it? We got to be able to do some pretty terrific things. And how are you going to do that? Well, you create reality with your mind. You can create your own reality. As Paul Yonggi Cho says, you can incubate your future and hatch the results. You control, you can create the presence of Jesus with the words of your lips, he says. We've got all kinds of people within the Church of Jesus today saying you can visualize Jesus and it'll be the real Jesus. And you can conjure him up and there he is. It's right out of the pit of hell, and it comes from Carl Jung. And I'm still trying to get to Carl Jung. But here's an interesting article. The actress who plays TV's Detective Cagney. An interview with Sharon Gless. You want to know what Sharon Gless says? About AIDS and the controversy. This is dated February 23rd, 1986. About AIDS and the controversy over on-screen open-mouth kissing, she says cheerily, in my reality, metaphysically speaking, AIDS ain't going to happen to me. Two or three times a month, Gless attends seminars at something called Concept Synergy in Mill Valley near San Francisco. There she has learned, she says, that, quote, you create your own reality. Things don't just happen to you. We're in control. She's going to awaken to a horrible reality that she never intended to create. I was in Austin, Texas, a few weeks ago. They were having the 1986, well, it's going to be in June, June 19th through 22nd, the 1986 Seth SETH World Conference. Most of you don't know who Seth is. Seth is a seducing spirit that teaches doctrines of devils. Transcribe them to Jane Roberts, a psychologist. And people are coming from all over the world. About 6 or 8 books have been written by this entity out there, this seducing spirit. And people are coming from all over the world to the Third World Congress, World Conference, to discuss it. What do you think Seth teaches? What are these doctrines of devils? We create our own reality, literally, through the beliefs we hold, and therefore can change what we don't like. There is no authority superior to the guidance of a person's inner self. Seducing spirits, doctrines of devils, alive and well and active and growing in influence in our world today. This is an interesting, this is some Xerox copies of some pages out of one of Kenneth Hagin's booklets, Having Faith in Your Faith. He admits it. He teaches it. Jesus said, have faith in God. Do you know what he says? God had faith. This is page 2. God had faith in his own words. Jesus had faith in his own words too. Because there's power in words. And when you believe in your words, then you can do what God does. And you can call things that are not as though they were. Because you're in God's class. And there's power in words. And when you speak it forth, it must happen. Then he says, Jesus said, for whosoever shall say and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Why did he say whosoever? Why didn't he say if any of my disciples or some of my followers? Why did he say whosoever? Because all men are spirit beings. Even non-Christians can do this. We all have this power because, as Paul Yonggi Cho says, we're fourth dimension beings. And even occultists can tap into God's laws. And you will find in Pat Robertson's book, 200 Answers to Life's Most Oft-Asked Questions or something like that, on about page 270, exactly the same thing. We can all develop the law of faith and the law of miracles. Even non-Christians can do this. He says, it used to bother me when I'd see unsaved people getting results, but my church members not getting results. Then it dawned on me what the sinners were doing. They were cooperating with this law of God, the law of faith. Well, God makes his sun and his rain to fall upon the just and the unjust. And you don't have to be a Christian to tap into the nuclear energy in an atom or to grow flowers by the sweat of your brow and in competition to weeds. But you have to be a Christian to have faith, because faith is in God. And it's by grace through faith that you are saved. But they're saying that there are these laws out there and they work like, scientifically, this is Christian science. They're not backing away, these men. This is the latest book by Charles Capps. It's an incredible book. Did you know that your body gives you an authority on this earth that even God doesn't have? And on page 29 he says, that is why God, through the Holy Ghost, wants to inhabit your body. He says, just on the same page, he says, when Satan came into the garden to deceive Eve, he had to borrow a body from a serpent. Because even a serpent's body gives you authority. It has authority. It's just Mormonism, right? All over again. I mean, the Mormon gods, when they give birth to babies, they don't have bodies. It's a strange thing. Although the gods have bodies, when they give birth to babies, they don't have bodies. But human beings who haven't yet become gods, when they give birth to babies, they have bodies. So the spirits up there, that's why Mormons have to have big families. It's a sin to have any form birth control, because all of these spirits are waiting for bodies, because you've got to have a body to become a god. It's very similar. Oh, I'm not here to make you laugh, but he says some people have an image of God being 400 feet tall with arms as big as a building. But why would God make man a different size than he is? I'm convinced he made man just like himself. We're all the same size as God. He may live on a planet near a giant star called Kolob. He's about 6 feet tall up there. Look, I mean, we're laughing because it's funny, but it's tragic. It really is. Here's a book that was written against seduction of Christianity. It's called Seduction, A Biblical Response by the Reverend Thomas F. Reed. He has about a 4,000 member church in Buffalo, New York, and by one of his associates, Mark Verkler. And listen to what they say. My heart was deeply grieved as I encountered the accusation flowing through the book which I was reading. Well, I didn't know we were accusing anyone. We were simply quoting what people say, and if that's an accusation, then I guess it's out of their own mouths. The book recently published by Harvest House attacked many of the most significant spiritual leaders in the church today. You want to know who he lists as some of the most significant spiritual leaders? Well, we just were reading the writings of one of them. Charles Capps, one of the most significant spiritual leaders in the world today. On page 34, Charles Capps says, "We were created to be gods over the earth, but remember to spell it with a little g." It's okay if you spell it with a little g, folks. Some of the others, Morton Kelsey, that I just told you about, one of the most significant spiritual leaders in the church today. Ruth Carter Stapleton, who's no longer here, but anyway, he lists her in that capacity. Ruth Carter Stapleton, I can quote you from a tape of her, one of her talks, for example, at Christ Universal Temple in Chicago, a huge unity temple in Chicago, and I'm quoting her verbatim, "God is wholeness and you are God. In you he lives and moves and has his being." She got it backwards. Dennis and Matthew Lynn, well, John Wimber recommends them also very highly. These are Jesuit priests who have you visualizing Mary. And if anybody's here and you're involved, you've been involved in inner healing, you better ask yourself, if you're a Protestant, how is it that Catholics get just as good results visualizing Mary as Protestants get visualizing Jesus? And Rita Bennett says, visualize him like your favorite artist paints him. Calvin Miller says, it's not important what kind of an image you have, but you must have an image. This is a 1984 InterVarsity Press book. You create Christ, the Christ, in your mind. You create God's unseen world of the Spirit in your mind, in your imagination, or you will never confront it, he says. And you must have an image. The Bible says we're not to have an image. There's a new book for youth ministers, an evangelical book. And it gives you breathing exercises to put yourself in the state of consciousness that came out last year. And then it says, image God. And focus on this image, and it will speak to you. Wow. Being led right into contact with demonic entities. You've made contact with a spirit being, and it speaks, and it's not God. I guarantee you it's not God. That's called divination. If we could just hear the words of God to this generation, I think he would say the same as he said through Jeremiah 14:14, for example. The Lord said unto me, the prophets prophesy lies in my name. I sent them not, neither have I commanded them. Neither spake I unto them. They prophesy a false vision and divination. You know what divination is? Any methodology for getting in touch with God, for getting revelations. They prophesy a false vision and divination, a thing of naught, and the deceit of their own heart. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. But now the idea today is we get within ourselves, we begin to imagine, and it's out of our imagination. The first time you meet imagination in the Bible, Genesis 6:5, God looked down and saw that the imagination of man's heart was only evil continually. And go to Genesis 11, the Tower of Babel. And God comes down and he says, look out. Whatever they imagine, they're going to be able to do. And you think that was an extreme statement. Well, when I was a boy and I read Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon and so forth, it was pure fantasy. It was never going to happen, all this space travel and computers and television and all that kind of stuff. And it happened. Because we can do what we imagine eventually. Well, that's good, isn't it? No, because the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. No wonder Jeremiah said, "Oh Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his steps." But you're being taught across the Church of Jesus Christ to look within yourself and to activate your imagination and begin to visualize, and out of the depths of your imagination you will bring forth Dream Seeds by Mike Murdoch. He says, when David faced the giant Goliath, he mentally replayed his previous victories in killing the bear and the lion. Then he used his imagination to picture and pre-play his impending victory over Goliath. You never got that out of the Bible. You got that out of a self-help book. You got that out of the occult. You got that out of psychology. And then you tried to make the Bible fit. But my Bible says that David said, "I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, and he will deliver you into my hands." And we're being turned from God and the power of God by developing ourselves and our imagination and our powers. And Rita Bennett says, whatever this Jesus says, picture him like your favorite artist pictures him. Well, it reminds me of Sun Myung Moon, you know, when they had a big trial about a year or so ago in New York. You probably read about it. And they had him on the witness stand, and the attorneys on the other side were cross-examining him, and they said, "Well, you say that Jesus appeared to you, just like to Joseph Smith, about the same age, by the way, also. Gave him the same assignment." And the attorney said, "You say that Jesus appeared to you. How did you know it was Jesus?" "Oh," Sun Myung Moon said, "I recognized him from his picture." Well, that was a pretty embarrassing moment. But Rita Bennett says, visualize him like your favorite artist paints him. You'll recognize him from his picture. I mean, it's a delusion. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? I'm not here to put these people down. I'm not trying to make you laugh. I'm saying that when we read the Old Testament and we read God indicting the people of Israel with idolatry, I can just hear some of them say, "Well, now wait a minute. I know I've got an idol of Baal in my tent, but I'm really worshiping Jehovah." And you know what really helps? You got to have some visual, you know, something to focus on. I mean, absolutely forbidden. Do you know that every idol that was ever made out of clay or stone or wood was first of all formed within the mind a visual image? We are playing evangelical idolatry. We just aren't going the next step to form it out of clay or stone. And of course, the same ideas are out there everywhere for the young people. Remember Karate Kid? And Karate Kid, when he met his master, what was he doing? He was trimming a bonsai tree. And the master said, "Go ahead, here, trim one yourself." He says, "I wouldn't know how to do it. I've never done it." "Oh, it's very simple. You look within yourself. And you visualize a bonsai tree within. And whatever comes from within is perfect. And then you trim the tree on the outside to conform to the image you've seen within." It's flooding our world, seducing spirits, doctrines of devils. But what's astonishing, it comes into the church. And we are involved in idolatry. And we are tolerating this. We need to rise up against this and call out for God to purge the church of this sort of thing. Well, finally, I'm trying my best to wind it down. I want you to be able to ask some questions. Listen to this. The human mind does not think in pictures, in words, but rather in pictures. See, they said that I'm against visions and dreams. So they went to CompuBible and cranked out several hundred verses about visions and dreams. I'm not against visions and dreams if God gives them to you. I'm against visions and dreams that you conjure up in your mind and expect that God is going to sanctify them and go along with your imagination. But they said, the human mind doesn't think in words, but rather in pictures. When we were children, our parents pointed to the picture of a car, a horse, or airplane, and we began to associate the word with the image or picture. That's simply because God programmed the human mind to think in pictures. The language of the Holy Spirit is, according to Dr. Cho, and of course you wouldn't dare to criticize him because he has the largest church in the world. That means everything he says is right. The language of the Holy Spirit is, according to Dr. Cho, the language of vision and dream. That simply is a blatant lie. It's not true. And yet, because we don't think for ourselves, we accept this sort of thing. You think in pictures? Try to write something in pictures. Be a very primitive form of communication. What kind of a picture do you have when I talk about beauty, love, peace, righteousness, prudence, repentance, justice, wisdom? You got no vision. You got no image. Because you don't think in pictures. You think in words and concepts. And if you're going to confine yourself to images and pictures, you are going to deprive yourself of the depth of understanding and experience that God wants you to have in Himself. And furthermore, it is absolutely forbidden to make an image of God. And if the language of the Holy Spirit is images, then God can't tell you anything about Himself. It simply is not true. There's a book that has just come out by Jacques Ellul, The Humiliation of the Word. And there, here's a review from May 1986, Eternity. Maybe some of you saw it. He says, "The Humiliation of the Word expresses Ellul's concern over the denigration of language in the 20th century. Our generation has largely given up on language as the primary means of communication, preferring images instead. Whether it is television, computer graphics, or the psychological technique of visualization, images are primary while language and dialogue are eclipsed. We prefer images over the spoken word, first because we're lazy, and second because we demand everything immediately. Language is the medium with which we ask and answer the question of truth. With language, we're able to formulate our ethics and make judgments." You will notice there's no visual images for any of this. Ethics, judgments, formulate, language. "While the spoken word promotes reasoning, interaction, and careful thinking, the image," listen to this carefully, "the image promotes conformity and mass manipulation. When imagery becomes primary, our very humanity is threatened, to say nothing of the gospel and the truth of the Word of God." And this is sweeping the Church of Jesus Christ. Where did it come from? Just quickly. Sorry, but I can't leave without talking a little bit about Carl Jung. It came from a gentleman named Carl Jung. I received some letters from a pastor in Flushing, New York. Let me just read a little bit of what he had to say. He wrote to Jamie Buckingham. Jamie Buckingham was upset because we had said some things about Richard Foster's celebration of discipline in Seduction of Christianity. He says, "Dave Hunt's book caused me to do some research. For the past 6 months, I have been doing little else. I have arrived at the conclusion that Hunt is correct, and there is a massive seduction and deception in the church today, mainly within the charismatic movement. For this reason, I was very disturbed by your review of the book and your attitude toward Hunt's material. The deception, as I have tried to trace the roots of it, predominantly involves the theories and methodology of one Carl Gustav Jung. Consider this. You said that Richard Foster's book, Celebration of Discipline, is one of the classics of this generation. In his critique of Seduction of Christianity, he said, why, I have made that book required reading for all of the pastors on our staff. I've taught classes on it. I consider it to be a classic of this generation. He says, you said that Richard Foster's book, Celebration of Discipline, is one of the classics of this generation. The second chapter in the book pertains to meditation and is, in his own words, the most practical chapter in the book. What is the source of the material in that chapter? If you read Morton Kelsey's The Other Side of Silence, Paulus Press, you will find the source. Where did Kelsey get his insights on meditation and visualization? Morton Kelsey is an avowed Jungian. On what did Jung base his insights on meditation and visualization? Jung tells us that the antecedents for his work are to be found in heretical Gnosticism and medieval occult alchemy. His ideas came about as a result of his discovery that the ramblings of psychotics in a mental hospital in which he worked were similar in content to what he discovered in philological occult writings. Also, he strongly attributes his insights to an outside source, to his ghostly guru, Philemon, as he calls him, who was his spirit guide. He mainly attributes to Philemon his insights into the objective nature of his images. How does it make you feel that a book which you call a classic of this generation contains material attributable to Carl Jung's spirit guide? This is not some far-out contrivance. It can be demonstrated. I wrote and asked him, I said, Don, I'd be very interested to know what kind of a response you get from Jamie Buckingham. He wrote back in this letter, he says, I imagine you have truly come to appreciate the encouragement you receive, especially when you realize the massive nature of the deception you have uncovered. And then later in another paragraph, he says, I do not expect to receive a response from Jamie Buckingham. I believe he is very much involved in the Jungian trash. By chance, I received a tape by Dr. Bruce Morgan, who directed the New England Bible Institute and is very much involved in Kelseyism and Jack Sanford's Kingdom Within. On the tape, he spoke of Martin Kelsey as the prophet raised up by God for this age. He also tells of how he was led by the Spirit through a dream to move to Florida. You notice all the books coming into our Christian bookstores now? Dream analysis, dream interpretation, dream journaling, and so forth. Comes right from Carl Jung. He was led through a dream to move to Florida, where he attended Jamie's church in Melbourne. He was invited to preach and eventually was brought on staff as a teacher. He speaks of a dream interpretation class he holds at Jamie's church. So he says, I don't expect to hear from Jamie. He's involved in this thing. Carl Jung, a heavily demonized occultist. And his psychology is far more influential than Freud's. And his influence in the Church of Jesus Christ today is staggering, and in our society. Inner healing and all of this comes right out of Carl Jung. Carl Jung grew up in a haunted house where the poltergeist activity was so intense that his mother kept a daily journal of the spirit activity. She grew up in a similar house. Her father, a master mason and a Protestant minister in Switzerland, had to have her, Jung's mother, hold the spirits at bay long enough for him to write out his Sunday sermon. Jung's thesis was written on this subject. He was involved in seances. He was one who turned from the faith to embrace the doctrines of devils through seducing spirits. He rejected Christianity, and the Bible that Carl Jung carried with him wherever he went was the Bardo Thodol, the Tibetan Book of the Dead, that Timothy Leary, of course, used as his guide when he wrote Psychedelic Adventure. Carl Jung wrote the introductions to the first translations in Western languages of some of the occult books from the East, the early translations back there, on yoga and Zen and Buddhism and Hinduism and so forth. Carl Jung was the heir apparent to Freud's throne. Freud was Jewish. Jung was a WASP, a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. Not quite. He was Germanic in northern Switzerland. And Freud hoped that by having Jung take over as his crown prince, it would broaden the acceptance of his theories. But Freud did not believe in religious experiences. In fact, to this day, a Freudian psychoanalyst, one of the things that they have embedded in their minds is if you believe in God or you're religious, you're at the very least neurotic and probably psychotic, and you have to be delivered from this delusion. But Carl Jung, that's why he's the hero of the Christians. That's why so many of them like him. Go to the Fuller bookstore, Fuller Theological Seminary bookstore, and see how many books they've got over there tracing back to Jung and to Morton Kelsey and so forth. Because he talked about religious experiences. And when they first met in 1909, Jung and Freud had a little argument about this because Freud didn't believe it. And Carl Jung, who was what parapsychologists today call a poltergeist person, that is, this demonic activity happened in his presence. He said to Freud, I'll demonstrate it for you. And they were standing by a bookcase, and he said, you're going to hear a loud shot come right out of this. And out it came, and Freud, the great master, fainted. The second time they met, even worse things happened, and Freud fainted dead away again. And when Freud came to, he accused Jung of harboring a death wish against him. Freud had an obsessive fear of death. The guy was a basket case.
He was sick. He was demented. He was a cocaine addict, among other things. He thought cocaine was the cure-all, and his best friend died from a cocaine prescription that Freud gave to him. And these are the men that we honor and accept their theories. And we say all truth is God's truth. And we'll take it right out of the mouth of the devil himself. And that's what they're doing. Although he was a medical doctor, he couldn't go to a funeral. He couldn't even look at a corpse. He had an obsessive fear of death, and he accused Jung of harboring a death wish against him, which Carl Jung came to believe when in a dream he killed the Wagnerian hero Siegfried, which he interpreted as Siegfried. Dream interpretation. The man who popularized it and his theories are rampant is Carl Jung, okay? And after that dream, for 6 years, Carl Jung teetered on the brink of insanity, facing what he realized was a total psychotic breakdown, in communication with demonic entities, spirit beings, visited by the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove, all kinds of mystical experiences. And he picked up his spirit guide, Philemon, and it was out of this milieu of mysticism and occultism that he came forth with his basic theories. He enlarged Freud's unconscious to the collective unconscious. And he came up, he learned from his demonic seducing spirits about archetypal images and visualization and ancestral influence and contacting the dead. You can read his Septem Sermon, his seven sermons to the dead. He believed that he was chosen to talk to the dead. This is the man that is honored, and his theories are taught in our seminaries and in our Christian colleges and universities and are in the Church of Jesus Christ today, and it's the heart of inner healing. You want to know how inner healing works under Jungian analysis, depth analysis? Why, you visualize your archetype, your personal archetype in the past, that's you. And if you're a Christian, you would visualize your hero archetype coming alongside to deliver you from these traumas of the past. And of course, if you're a Christian, your hero archetype would be Jesus. If you're a Catholic, your hero archetype would be Mary or Joseph. If you're a Buddhist, your hero archetype would be Buddha. And it works just as well. It works. It's terrific. The spirits make it work. Do I have to say more? You see where it comes from? And we have embraced these things and honored them. And my heart breaks. I can't comprehend it. Here's an article. This is Presbyterian Renewal News, March, April, 1986. I don't know how many of you have heard of the Benedictine Abbey at Picos, New Mexico, a popular Catholic charismatic retreat center. A lot of your inner healers go there, and that's where they learn it. It is union to the core. And the abbot who is in charge says, truth is truth wherever it is found. Whatever is true in union psychology can be adapted and used by Christians. But those who turn to Jung for insight into the spiritual life must also be prepared, both intellectually and spiritually, to distinguish where his ideas fall short of the truth revealed to us in Scripture and Christian tradition. Just plug in the name of Mary Baker Eddy, or plug in the name of Anton LaVey, or anybody else. All truth is God's truth, but read them with discernment. I am shocked, I am saddened, I am heartbroken. I don't know what to say, and I've said a lot for a man who doesn't know what to say, but I don't think that I have yet come to grips with the enormity of what we're facing, and with the seriousness of it, and the consequences, the eternal consequences, for people within the Church of Jesus Christ, who I believe are being led astray. And Jesus said, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? In your name we cast out devils, in your name we did miracles. And I will say, I never knew you. Could it be that there are such people alive on the earth today? Could it be that they're on Christian television? Could it be that they're in the pulpits of some of our churches? Could it be that we have a responsibility to do something. I believe we do, and I don't know what to tell you to do. I'm doing what the Lord has put on my heart. But I think we've got to get serious with God. And we've got to realize that people are being damned for eternity. And maybe the blood of some of them is on our hands. Father, we bow before you, Lord, and we scarcely know how to deal with what we see. We have believed in the last days. We have believed in the rapture and Armageddon and the Antichrist and the delusion, the seduction, and all of these things that were coming in the future. But Father, it seems like we have awakened as out of a dream to find ourselves in the midst of it happening. And Lord, you know one of our fears is we don't want to become paranoid. We don't want to become fanatics. We're afraid of going out on a limb and making accusations that aren't true and becoming alarmists and seeing things that aren't there. But Father, help us not to flee from the conviction that your Holy Spirit would put upon us. And show us what is happening. Open our eyes. And show each of us what we can do in prayer and in speaking out, perhaps contacting people that we ought to contact and solemnly, seriously speaking with them, confronting them. Lord, whatever we have to do, we ask that you will deal with our hearts now and work in my heart and in each of our hearts. And Father, help us to rescue as many as we possibly can before it is too late. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm sorry we ran out of time, but maybe we can have questions and answers another time. I don't know where our brother is. Here he is. Okay.